Hi everyone, my name is Sahil Chawla. I'm an MCAT tutor here at Shemmassian Academic Consulting. Today, we'll be going over an organic chemistry passage, and I'll discuss some of the strategies you can use when encountering questions like these on the MCAT. All right, so I've got the passage pulled up here in front of me, basically just gonna read it out loud, think out loud so you know exactly what's going on in my head when I'm reading through such a passage, and then we'll also go over the questions as well. For test day and just for your own independent practice, you should be going at a pace around 8 minutes per passage. Since I'm gonna be walking through this, we're gonna be going a little bit slower than that, but for your own independent practice, shoot for around 8 minutes per passage. All right, so with that all out of the way, let's go ahead and start with our first paragraph. In a new study, researchers aim to synthesize diindolyl methane, definitely just butchered that, but we'll go with what they give us here in parentheses, or DIM, derivatives-based thiadiazole as a new class of urease inhibitors. DIM is a natural product alkaloid used extensively in medicinal chemistry. Alrighty, so just to really help my help myself engage with the text, I like to use the outlining strategy to kind of take what I'm reading and put into my own words. So they talk about these DIM derivatives here, and that they are urease inhibitors. Urease is an enzyme that basically is involved with the hydrolysis of urea. So it looks like DIM is gonna be inhibiting that reaction by inhibiting urease. So just to summarize this, I think really simple, just DIM, urease, I think that'll suffice. All right, let's go ahead and dive into the second paragraph. Researchers first synthesized several DIM-based thiadiazole analogs 1 through 18 and characterized them by various spectroscopic techniques such as 1H-NMR, 13C-NMR, and EIMS. Then the analogs were evaluated for urease, parentheses they give us jack bean urease, inhibitory potential. All compounds showed excellent to moderate inhibitory potential with an IC50 value within the range of 0.5 plus or minus 0.01 to 33.2 plus or minus 1.2 micromolars compared with the standard thiourea, parentheses that give us 21.6 plus or minus 0.7 micromolars, and then the synthetic pathway for the analogs is shown in figure 1 right here. Alrighty, so after reading that paragraph, we can also see, yep, this is the pathway where we're forming these analogs, right? Compounds 1 through 18. So a lot is really discussed there, but just to really break it down, what I'm getting is that there are these DIM analogs, right, that they had synthesized. Then they analyzed them using spectroscopic techniques, right? HNMR, NMR, right? So I would put spectroscopy. And lastly, they just kind of talked about the inhibitory potential, right? So I'll just put inhibitory potential, just kind of using my own little shorthand here. I know what that means, and since this outline is kind of for me, that's gonna be okay. So use shorthand in your outlines as well, just to save some time. Just make sure you remember what the words meant that you wrote down. Alrighty, and so I like that as my outline for paragraph 2, so let's go ahead and go to paragraph 3. Compound A, or IC50, which is equal to 0.5, compound 8, and in parentheses they give us IC50 equal to 0.5 plus or minus 0.01 micromolars, close parentheses, was the most potent inhibitor amongst all derivatives. In the next step, researchers used X-ray crystallography to determine structure-activity relationships for the compounds. Researchers discovered that compound 8 forms a pi-stacking interaction with a conserved Y87 residue within urease. Mutation of Y87 to alanine decreases compound 8 potency by 3.7-fold. The key binding interactions of most active compounds with enzyme were confirmed through molecular docking studies. All right, another paragraph with a lot of information. What I see they're talking about is that we have this compound of interest, which is compound 8, and I really, seeing this right here, these Y87 residue, was really, really stood out to me, because amino acids are such a high yield topic. So when I see amino acids appearing in a passage. That's definitely something I want to take note of. You'll see amino acids not only in the bio and biochem section, but also in the chem phys section. That's just how high yield amino acids are, and even biochemistry in general. And on my test day, I even saw biochemistry type questions in my CP section of my exam. So for me, what's really important here is that we had this compound 8, and that when there was this mutation into alanine for the 87 position, right, that there was this 3.7 fold decrease. So if I had to summarize this, I would write C8Y87A decreased 3.7 fold. And in case you're not aware, the notation for writing out like wild type and or mutations for amino acids is basically just you put down the wild type amino acid, its position number, and then the mutant. All right, so if we look at this one right here, Y, that's our wild type, 87 is our position number, and then alanine here, our A, that's the mutant. Just bringing this up because you'll definitely see this right here, a good amount with amino acids, again, being such a high yield topic, mutations with amino acids, you'll see them written out like this. So it's good to know, you know, which one is the wild type, which one is the mutant. All right, so now with the passage out of the way, let's go ahead and dive into the questions. So question one, which of the following is not a strong acid? So when I see not, least, except, words like that in a question stem, I always like to highlight them just because the MCAT's such an exhausting exam. It's very easy to like overlook a small detail like that, and then you might spend a lot of time digging through the question, the answer choices, and looking for which one is a strong acid. Right, so I like to just, you know, highlight it on my exam for not, except, least, words like that. So the answer choices they give us are A, hydrochloric acid, so that's HCl. They gave us acetic acid, so CH3COOH. Hydrobromic acid, I see HBr, and then sulfuric acid, which is H2SO4. So essentially for this question, you really just need to know what are your strong acids. So I know HCl, HBr, and H2SO4 are our strong acids. So acetic acid is gonna be the right answer here. Acetic acid is known as a weak acid. So B will be a right answer. Make sure you are familiar with the strong acids. The other ones are gonna be like perchloric acid, so HClO4. You're gonna have hydroiodic acid, so HI. And then you'll have HNO3, which is nitric acid. So make sure you know these strong acids. Acetic acid is not one of them. So again, B is our best answer. Let's go ahead and dive into question two. During the first step of the reaction, figure one, all right, so the first step, which of the following functional groups present on the reactants is, again, not present in the product? So in the first step of the reaction, so this right here, which of these functional groups is found here in the reactants but not here in the products? So aromatic rings, well, I see them right here, and I also see them right here. So these right here. So these are our aromatic rings. So I see a lot of those, and even as the reaction continues, they basically just, they're there the whole time. So definitely not gonna be A. B, aldehyde. So I see my aldehyde right here, right? Because an aldehyde group is basically this right here. However, when I look over here, I do not see it. I just see, the closest thing I see is this right here, but that's a carboxylic acid group. And so carboxylic acid is one of the other answer choices. And, you know, it is present here in the reactants, but it's also present in the product. So we can actually use that information to eliminate an answer choice C. And so still really thinking it's probably gonna be aldehyde. Let's look at answer choice D. They say amines here, so I see that right here, and of course I see amines in the products as well. So it's not D, looks like B, again, is our best answers. In case you're not familiar with amines, they come in the primary, secondary, tertiary. A primary amine would be something like this. A secondary would be this, and then a tertiary would be this. So if it has no hydrogens, it's going to be tertiary, one hydrogen secondary, and then two hydrogens going to be primary. And then in all of these, the nitrogen has one lone pair here. So something you should know for the MCAT, just like amino acids are a very high yield biochemistry topic, your functional groups are one of the highest yield topics as well. And knowing your functional groups can actually save you a lot of time if you just know how these different functional groups react and how they behave. Then there's a lot of other material you don't really have to memorize, like certain reactions, because you'll know the fundamentals of functional groups, and that can guide your problem solving when you're working with very complicated reactions. So this question here, if you weren't able to get the right answer, I would say really review your functional groups. Alrighty, so let's go ahead and move on to question three. Alright, so they ask, which of the following urease mutations at position 87 is most likely to maintain pi stacking interactions with compound 8? Alright, so they mentioned specifically pi stacking interactions. Pi stacking interactions are formed between aromatic rings. So the answer choice that we choose, whether it's alanine, proline, threonine, or phenylalanine, needs to be one that has aromatic rings. So alanine is a pretty simple amino acid. It's just basically CH3 for its side chain. Proline is gonna look a little something like this. It's a little bit more complicated, but you have CH2 here, you'll have another CH2, and then another CH2, and then it ties in here to form this little structure. And then this is the kind of the rest of the amino acid, like backbone here, you know, you'll have your O minus, and then you'll have a hydrogen here. So this is not an aromatic ring. You know, this is what an aromatic ring looks like. You know, we can see them here in our figure one here, like this is an aromatic ring. This would not be. So it's not A, it's not B. Threonine, since I'm running out of space, maybe I'll write it, and let's put that this was answer choice A, this was B. So threonine, it looks something like this. You got the rest of the backbone kind of up here, and then you have carbon, you got this hydroxyl, a methyl group here, and this carbon is also bound to an oxygen. So this is threonine. Here, again, we don't see an aromatic ring, so we can eliminate C. That leaves us with D, and it is correct because phenylalanine, and since I've run out of space here, I'm gonna probably just write it up here. Phenylalanine looks something like this, CH2, and then this little aromatic ring. And so with that, having the aromatic ring, it means it's gonna be the one that's most likely to maintain the pi stacking interactions. So D is our best answer. Alrighty, let's go over the last question. Researchers want to decrease the rate of product formation from the second step of the reaction, figure one, which the following would, again, not decrease, let's go ahead and underline that or highlight it, would not decrease the rate of compound two formation according to Le Chatelier's principle. All right. So Le Chatelier's principle is just basically this idea where when a stress is placed on a reaction, it's gonna shift in a way to alleviate that stress. So these are the options they give us. A, decrease the concentration of the bromine containing initial reactant. All right, so if we were to decrease, so this is our bromine containing reactant. If we decrease the concentration of this, what you would have is a shift towards this way, towards the reactants here, right? So because this is going down, we have less material or less, if you kind of want to look at this as, kind of balancing the reaction in a sense, that if we have less of this now, that means our reaction is going to shift this way to restore the balance here. So we would have more of our initial reaction forming here, and in and we would also have compound two right here, its formation would decrease because there's less of this starting material. So summarize, with this going down, the reaction would shift this way. So A is not going to be the right answer because the question asks us which one does not decrease the rate of compound 2 formation, and A does decrease the rate of compound 2 formation. All right, B, decrease the concentration of aldehyde and carboxylic acid containing initial reactant. All right, so this right here is our aldehyde and carboxylic acid containing initial reactant, and the same logic as our justification for why A is wrong applies here for why B is going to be wrong. If this is decreased, then this thing, this reaction is going to shift that way. And again, we're decreasing the formation of compound two. Question asks us which doesn't decrease that rate of formation. Since B does, we can eliminate it. C, decrease the concentration of compound two. All right, so take that same logic we've been applying with A and B and see what happens here. If when we lower, like let's say for answer choice A, when we lowered this reactant here, our reaction shifted to restore the balance and decreased the rate of formation for the products here. So if we're doing kind of the same thing now, but with compound two, right? If we're decreasing compound two's concentration, then we would have this reaction actually shift to restore that balance and increase that concentration of compound two. So this one would increase the concentration of compound two or the rate of compound two formation. So it would not, this would be, you know, the one that does not decrease the rate of compound two formation. So I really like this as an answer choice. Let's go ahead and look at answer choice D before we lock in C. Decrease the concentration of compound one. So again, apply the same logic we've used for A, B, and C, and look at compound one here. If we decrease this concentration, then we would have this part of the reaction shifting to the right, right? In our first step, we would have this shift right, and in our second step, the compound two, right, this reaction here would actually shift left here. So just looking at this reaction here, if we're decreasing the concentration of our reactant that forms the product of compound two, then we're gonna get more reactant formation and less of our compound two or product formation. So D does decrease the rate of compound two formation, making it incorrect, and so C is our best answer. All right, so that's gonna wrap things up for us today. So the key things really being, if you weren't able to get question one, definitely review your strong acids. For question two, definitely review the functional groups. Three, your amino acids are huge, right? And for four, review Le Chatelier's principle. These are all high yield topics for test day. So make sure that if you did miss any of these questions that you go back to your content review books or check out one of our MCAT review content guides on these topics that you might have struggled with. Thanks so much for watching this video. If you found it helpful, please give it a like. Subscribe to our channel to stay up to date with all our content. And check out the link in the description below where you can sign up for a free MCAT question of the day email, where you basically will just get a free MCAT question sent to your email every morning. So that's gonna wrap things up for us today. Have a great one and happy studying.